Hi, and welcome to the Future of Dermatology podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Faranak Kamangar, board-certified dermatologist. We are here to talk about anything and everything dermatology-related. You'll hear from me and my guests, who are dermatologists, physicians, experts, scientists, residents, and medical students in the field of dermatology. We publish weekly, so if you like what you hear, hit that subscribe button and show us some love, and thank you for joining us.
Hi, we are back today with our amazing guest, Dr. Amit Pandya, and our SF Derm community knows Dr. Pandya so well. He's spoken at many of our conferences. He's speaking again at our next meeting in Napa, which we're very excited about. Dr. Amit Pandya, I'm lucky enough to have him as a colleague at the Palo Alto Medical Foundation, and he's also volunteer teaches at UCSF with the residents and the dermatology clinic there. And we know him as a world expert in vitiligo and pigmentary disorders. So thank you so much, Dr. Pandya, for joining us.
Happy to be here. Thanks for the invitation.
One of the areas that clinicians struggle with pigmentary disorders and vitiligo specifically, is when you're seeing a patient, it's always so great to kind of get an idea of what goes on through your mind. Let's say you walk into a patient, new patient coming in, new diagnosis of vitiligo. How do you approach it? We'd love to kind of just get into your mind of what you do and how you look at it.
Yes, I mean, I think that's super important, because that's going to, of course, determine which pathway, which strategy you're going to use as you take care of this patient on an ongoing basis. And I think shared decision making is probably one of the most important tenets to remember, because I've been surprised at how some patients with relatively extensive disease may decide that, after hearing all the treatments, I really don't want to have a treatment, especially the lighter skin patients, where it's not that noticeable if they will wear sunscreen. And then yet there's other patients who may have the tiniest lesion, and that might be causing extreme stress, and they would do anything, even surgical therapies, to treat that. So I think shared decision making is going to be one of the most important tenets to remember as you approach these patients. So what I do is I first try to determine what is the extent of the lesions and where are they. If you have lesions, for example, just in a localized area, especially if it's segmental, then you know the treatment's going to be faster, and it's probably going to be easier. If you have it in over multiple areas of the body, then it might be more difficult, especially if the locations are over bony prominences. Those bony prominences, wrists, ankles, hands, feet, elbows, knees, they tend to be harder to treat. So that's, and of course, I'm constantly thinking in my mind as I'm examining the patient about what am I going to tell the patient about prognosis. And as I'm going through, I'm looking at the size of the lesions. Lesions that are going to be over a couple centimeters in diameter are going to be harder to treat than lesions that are smaller, because when melanocytes migrate from the edges, they only can migrate like maybe at the most 1 centimeter, and then they get stuck. And if these are areas without hairs, then those lesions really don't get that much better. But if you have lesions with small hairs, whether they're vellus hairs or terminal hairs that are black, then you can have success. So I'm looking at the size of the lesions. I'm looking at the location of the lesions. And then I'm using my dermatoscope to look at the actual lesions to see if the hairs are black or white. And if over 50% of the hairs are white, then they're going to have a worse prognosis versus those who have black hairs. And so those are some of the most important things that I'm doing in my physical exam as I'm looking at the patient. And in a light skin patient, let's say skin types 1, 2, 3, especially, then I'm using a Woods lamp in a very dark room, a very dark room. I've been amazed at how it takes a little time for my eyes to adjust to really be able to see the subtle lesions. And so what I'm looking for are trichrome lesions. I'm looking for confetti-like lesions, and of course the Koebner phenomenon, because those are important for me to detect with normal light and Woods lamp, because that's going to determine if I'm going to recommend dexamethasone for 3 months, or if I'm going to recommend tofacitinib, or one of the new JAK inhibitors that'll be coming up in a year. If they have those signs of activity and spreading, then I'm going to use those, and the patient will have a better prognosis with that systemic therapy than if they're just using topical therapy and phototherapy.
That's so great. It's such a good overview of where to triage almost our patients, which is an important tool to teach. It's actually kind of a hard one to pick up. You've picked this up over decades of seeing vitiligo patients. And I think sometimes it's hard for physicians who see vitiligo every once in a while to kind of have that in their mind. So thank you so much for going over that and then touching on going to kind of more systemic medicines earlier. Do you find that's a trend that you're doing more often, or is it really just based on if you feel like they're in a higher risk category?
I think that with the systemic therapy, you know, dexamethasone is usually given, let's say, for an average 150-pound person. You know, there's multiple studies that have been published in Asia, and then we published a study here in the United States. The dose is usually 3 milligrams, sometimes 4 milligrams for a typical 150-pound person. Of course, we cut that back depending on what their weight is. And a child, of course, will use it based on their weight. If it's a 50-pound child, we'll use 1 milligram, for example. But that'll be on 2 consecutive days a week for 12 weeks. And that's really been found to be the best regimen with the least side effects after multiple experiments with different types of steroids and different regimens. But the problem is that even that will give you side effects in some patients. So weight gain, acne, et cetera. So I'm really looking forward to the new JAK inhibitors that are going to be coming up. I think in 2026, we're going to have at least 1, perhaps 3 JAK inhibitors approved for vitiligo. But right now, some patients are getting tofacitinib, 5 milligrams twice a day, which has been published in multiple studies to be helpful for vitiligo, especially in patients with active disease. It's just very difficult to get that reimbursed. Some patients are getting that from other countries that are selling it in a generic form, especially, you know, we live in a society that travels a lot. So I do have some patients who are getting it from other countries. And I do see that it stabilizes, not as fast as dexamethasone does for active patients, but it definitely can stabilize, and you can use it long term. As long as you're checking blood tests, you know, every few months, you can use that much longer term than dexamethasone. And I would say about half of my patients that come into my office will show signs of activity. So I'm using those. I will, going back just to mention one thing, is that I've been amazed that in terms of shared decision making, how some patients are only focused on one area. So for example, I saw a patient today who has extreme vitiligo from the neck down, probably 90% of the color is gone, but he is only concerned with the face and neck. And his face is like 90% pigmented, and he wears a cap, and then his neck is about 50% pigmented. And so when people see him, he has white hands, but his face is normally pigmented. His neck is, at least the upper neck is normally pigmented. And that's the way he wants to live. He wants to treat just those areas with phototherapy and cream and let the other areas go. So I'm always just amazed at what people want. And it's so important to make sure you have that conversation about what it is that their goal is.
Oh, absolutely. It's so true. And it's so great to have more tools in the armamentarium, because people do really, it's good to have the choices of mixing. Do you find with phototherapy, are you still kind of going to that, or is it really just depend on the patient? Do you kind of offer the options of dexamethasone, phototherapy, JAK inhibitors, or do you kind of, in your head, offer one more than the other?
I think that, I explain to all of my patients that there's really 2 main pillars of therapy. One is to reduce the T cells that are attacking the skin that are causing vitiligo. And I do explain to them so that they can, at least in their mind, mechanistically understand that in their vitiligo lesions, and especially at the edges, out of the bloodstream are these little cells called T cells that are crawling into their epidermis, finding their melanocytes and killing them. And one of our goals is to remove those T cells, and removing those T cells will not make those spots better. It'll simply keep them from going away. And it's so important to remember how that's so different from psoriasis and eczema. When you get rid of those T cells in psoriasis and eczema, the lesions get better. But when you get rid of those T cells in vitiligo, usually nothing happens unless there is some type of light, whether it's sunlight or phototherapy, that makes it better. So I tell patients that if you really want the lesions to get better and your goal is not just simply to keep it from spreading, then you really should have some type of light. And, you know, phototherapy, of course, is the most effective light. Three times a week is more effective than twice a week. And if a person has many lesions, then I usually recommend whole body phototherapy rather than eczema or localized therapy, because I want to prevent next week's lesion and next month's lesion by treating all the skin. And so I do try to get all of my patients on some type of light. Now, if they can't do phototherapy, I try to get them home phototherapy. And if they can't do that, then I have them to at least try to get some type of sunlight exposure. And I'm talking about a small amount, like maybe start with 5 minutes, three times a week, and then build up, you know, to tolerance. I certainly don't want them to get excessive amount of sun. But that combination of getting rid of the T cells and then using phototherapy is key. So then the question is then what is the treatment of the T cell? How do you get rid of them? Well, all the treatments we have, whether it's topical steroids, tacrolimus, pimecrolimus, the ruxolitinib cream, Opzelura, oral steroids, oral JAK inhibitors, all of them just work on removing those T cells. And so I tend to use those based on how the patient presents. If they don't have a lot of active disease, and especially if it's not a huge amount on their body, then of course I'll use topicals on their skin. You can't use the Opzelura on more than 10% of the body surface area. So if somebody has large areas, then I'll tend to use a topical steroid like medium potency, such as triamcinolone, over the large areas of the body. And I try to give them a little break, like maybe the weekends off, so they don't get stretch marks and thinning of the skin. But I really do like the tacrolimus and Opzelura for, you know, face and neck and visible areas of the body. I don't think it works so well on the hands, but certainly face and neck. And that's typically what I'll do to try to control the T cells. And as I mentioned earlier, if they do have signs of activity, confetti-like lesions, trichrome lesions, or Kebner phenomenon, then I will go to oral dexamethasone or an oral JAK inhibitor.
That's so helpful. And it actually makes me think of one more kind of group of patients. Every once in a while, and I'm sure you see this all the time, we'll get a vitiligo patient who's had it for a long time, has maybe not wanted to treat aggressively, but just checks in to see if there's anything new. How do you kind of approach that kind of patient where it's really hard to know if you're going to be able to get some pigment back?
Yeah, I get that all the time because they're starting to see advertisements on TV and they come in wondering if there's something new for them. So again, the same tenets that I said earlier do remain for them. So if they're not getting treatment because they only have lesions on their hands, feet, elbows, knees, ankles, and wrists, and they think that these new treatments are going to make a difference there, then they're out of luck. So I say, you know, these treatments are mainly for controlling your vitiligo, not necessarily repigmenting these difficult to repigment areas. However, if they're coming in and they have active lesions, they have lesions in areas that have black hairs, especially like face, and they don't have lots of leukotrichia, and they still have black hairs in those areas, I've been amazed at patients who haven't had treatment for 30 years and get on proper treatment, as I've just told you, and how much better they get. They're just surprised. Sometimes it's not necessary that we have these new fancy treatments. It has more to do with the fact that finally someone explains to them what's going on in their body, and then they're compliant with these treatments, and then they can see those results. And I think one of the reasons they stay compliant is because I see them every 3 months, and I take photographs of every single lesion so that they can see the 10 or 25% improvement in their lesions. Otherwise, they don't know if they're better. I don't know if they're better. And then that motivates them to continue with the phototherapy and continue with the treatment.
Well, that's fantastic. This is so helpful just to try to get into your mind. As you're saying, your vitiligo patients, and we're so lucky to have you at PAMF because when it gets hard, we can send to Dr. Pandya, which is also a really great thing to have. And then we always, at the end of the podcast, ask, since it's the Future of Dermatology podcast, what are you excited about for the field of vitiligo in the future?
Well, I think that one of the problems with the current treatments we have is that, you know, steroid creams can cause side effects. Tacrolimus doesn't work so well on like below the neck. the topical JAK inhibitors, we're only allowed to apply it to 10% of the body surface area or less. And it doesn't prevent next week's lesion and next month's lesion because you don't apply it to normal skin. Well, we have three JAK inhibitors that are going to be JAK1 or JAK3 inhibitors, so they are safer than the current JAK inhibitors we have. You know, we have tofacitinib, which is a JAK1-3. We have ruxolitinib oral, which is JAK1-2. And they have black box warning and more side effects. So the hope is that these JAK1 inhibitors or JAK3 inhibitors, that they'll have lower side effects and we'll see a result in vitiligo. So the phase two studies definitely showed a result. It was more delayed than what we're seeing with ruxolitinib cream results. However, it was sustained, you know, even after 6 months, we were seeing improvement. And hopefully after 1 year, we'll continue to see improvement. Well, this phase three studies are all going on right now. And if they show that same improvement, then hopefully in 2026, we'll have at least one new oral JAK inhibitor that we can use in patients with active disease, extensive disease, or patients who just don't want to rub things, you know, on their skin. We're also doing a study with afamelanotide, and this is a totally different kind of approach in which it stimulates melanocytes because it's a melanocyte stimulating hormone analog. And you're doing that study with me, the phase three study. And in that one, we're hoping that the melanocytes at the edges of the lesions, as well as the ones at the base of the hair follicles, will repigment the skin faster with phototherapy than with phototherapy alone. And that's an exciting study that hopefully we'll have the results next year. I think the big holy grail and the most difficult area are the hands, feet, elbows, knees, wrists, and ankles. And these are really important to patients because this is what the world sees. And my hope is that one day we'll figure out a way to transplant melanocytes to these areas using some type of super invasive technique, perhaps with injections or microneedling or some way to get these melanocytes in there without having to laser off the skin and then pour them on like we're doing right now with our melanocyte grafting. But that, to me, I think is the pie-in-the-sky future. I'm hoping that technology will improve so that we can figure out how to get them into these areas to really replace these melanocytes in areas where there are absolutely no melanocytes left.
That's fascinating. And the world of vitiligo is so exciting now because I feel like maybe even years ago, we were very limited, and now there's so much excitement about the therapies coming out, and it's going to be great for the patients. I think it's just the amazing patient population. So it's so great to see more and more solutions coming out.
Yep. It's the most exciting time in my 35-year career for vitiligo. So it is exciting.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Pandya. Thank you for all of your generous time that you give us at SF Derm and teaching everyone. And just hopefully this all translates to everyone treating their vitiligo patients better and treating more aggressively when needed. And I think it's going to make a huge difference for our derm community. So thank you so much again.
It's a pleasure to talk to you today, Farah.
Thank you for listening to the Future of Dermatology podcast. Remember to hit that subscribe button and share the podcast with your friends. The more you share and subscribe, the more we'll be able to grow and share our dermatology knowledge. If you have burning dermatology questions, feel free to leave them in the comment below, and we would love to address them in a future episode. And please note that this podcast is not intended to substitute for medical advice from your doctor.